Hello again. I'm Dr. Hung Vu, and our show is America's Healthcare Crisis. The title for our program tonight is The Views of Foreign Medical Graduates. I am a foreign medical graduate. I began my medical education in Vietnam, then went to continue and graduate in France before coming to America for further studies and training. Because of my cultural and educational backgrounds, my understanding of the healthcare crisis in America is different from that of the American graduates. During tonight's program, I will have the opportunity to interview two other physicians who are also foreign medical graduates, one from Poland and the other one from Iran. I'm hoping that through this interview, we have the chance to contribute our share in the effort to find answers to certain difficult issues that are facing medicine in America today. After all, the greatness and the strength of America are based largely on the contribution of individuals who have brought with them the knowledge and the wisdom they have learned from other parts of the world. So with that in mind, I'd like to introduce my guests. Dr. Anna Steiner is an anesthesiologist in practice in Stockton, and she's a native of Poland. She is a graduate from the University of Gdańsk in Poland. How are you tonight, Dr. Steiner?
Thank you. Thank you for inviting me here.
Welcome to our show. Thank you for being here. Our second guest is Dr. Ibrahim Ahmadi. He's from Iran. He's a graduate of the National University of Iran, and he's a family practitioner currently in private practice in Fremont. Welcome to our show.
Thank you very much, Dr. Wu.
So let's start with Dr. Steiner. Why don't you briefly tell us a summary of the odyssey, the long and difficult odyssey you have gone through before getting to this point, being in a prestigious specialty, practicing in a mainstream American community, which is Stockton.
Short story of my 8 years being in this country is I left Poland in 1985 mm-hmm. with a 6 years old son, and during the time when it was tough time in to Poland. Be in mm-hmm. practice, and I came to Oakland, California, and tried to go back to being a physician. I was practicing in Poland for 5 years, and I had a PhD in skin diseases. And landed in California, I found out that I am required to pass few exams mm-hmm. to be eligible for the residency program mm-hmm. and repeat my specialty. Mm-hmm. It took me 1.5 years to, at appropriate time, every 1/2 year took different exams. In meantime, I supported myself in different way. Not having money, not being a political refugee, I couldn't obtain the welfare, so I live in the car for a few months. I live
really?
In the garage. my son, 6 years old, thought it's his home. It's a Half Moon Bay mm-hmm. where I park the car and we live there. And okay. he was a surfer since he was 6 years old. And overall, we did it. And after 1.5 years of hard work and persistency and determination, I passed my exams and applied for residency. Uh-huh. And I've got residency in Worcester, Massachusetts, mm-hmm. University of Massachusetts. Mm-hmm. And I spent there 1 year in family practice and next 4 years being anesthesiologist, being specialized in anesthesia. Mm-hmm. And in 1992, I finished my residency. And 8 months ago, I accepted a job in Stockton Hospital, in County Hospital, which mm-hmm. I enjoy a lot. And since then, I enjoy my work and...
Great. So actually, you're going to be soon certified in anesthesiology, right?
I passed with a very high score my written exam, and mm-hmm. right now I'm in the process to take oral exams for okay. anesthesia in September 94.
That's marvelous. Within 8 short years, you came from very...
I came from the bottom of the bottom, cleaning yeah. houses and nursing aid at night and yeah. walking in Oakland with a knife in my purse and small baby next to me.
Welcome to America. Welcome to America, the land of opportunity. I'm glad to hear
for
that.
For me,
that's
think
marvelous.
It was, and it is, yeah. And I enjoy this country, and I met so many wonderful people helping me and trying to help, and I've got so much to be thankful.
Yeah. How about you, Dr. Maria? What's your story?
I entered medical school in 1974 after taking a board exam in my country that I was competing with 50,000 other students. And they were accepting only 1,000 of the top of the students. And mm-hmm. I went to the medical school. I finished it 1982. Then I started to do my internal medicine residency. Mm-hmm. Then by the government requirements, I went to Iran and Iraq war battlefield for 2 years, and I was spending time with the soldiers that they were injured and the civilian people that they were injured by all of those missiles. And after that, I decided to come to United States because always I had in my mind that I have to be trained in United States because I had believed that this is the country that you can get all of the opportunities and the knowledge. So I decided to leave my country, and I came to Germany, got my visa. Then I left my wife and my little girl back there to come here and organize thing, and that's the way that you went through it, to bring them over here. So I landed in Berkeley with my brother. Mm-hmm. And I was very fortunate that I had three other brothers living here. They mm-hmm. were Stanford students and they were Berkeley students. Mm-hmm. And I joined them. After 8 months, my wife came over here with mm-hmm. a lot of difficulties to get visa and everything.
Yeah.
And I spent 2.5 years studying day and night, weekends, holidays, and mm-hmm. all of the time to learn English language from zero. In my country, nobody talks English at all.
Gee,
and when I
amazing.
Came here, 1985, I knew nothing about English language. The only thing that I had was a little bit of ability to read English, that's it. And when I decided, you know, to go through the whole process, I saw
that was how long ago?
1985.
So 9 years.
It's almost 9 years. And it took 2.5 years for me to learn English from zero to university level, mm-hmm. and going through all of the medical school material all over again, and mm-hmm. taking the FMG exam, which is mm-hmm. a required and is standard exam to be known mm-hmm. to American society that he is a physician. Mm-hmm. Actually, I was practicing back home for 3 years when I left the country, mm-hmm. and after passing those exam, I took the flex exam as the way that she did mm-hmm. to be certified for licensing. Mm-hmm. And I looked for residency, and my first mm-hmm. goal was family practice mm-hmm. because I worked many years in family practice field, and I felt that this is the best way to mm-hmm. serve my patients mm-hmm. and to give, you know, give my contributions to the people.
Yeah.
And that was the first goal, and it's the first goal always that when I see any patient mm-hmm. and I applied for residency.
When did you get your training in family practice? Where do you have your residency?
I applied to several programs, and finally I got a position in Maryland. Actually,
Maryland, uh-huh.
I applied 600 applications to all of the places, and I got only 10 replies from the other uh-huh. programs. And out of 10, I went for 6 interviews. Mm-hmm. And finally, I landed in Maryland mm-hmm. at a family practice program, which was close to my friends. I had a couple of the family members in East Coast. Mm-hmm. And I spent 3 years in Maryland to do my residency. Then mm-hmm. I finished 1992. Mm-hmm. Then I moved back to California mm-hmm. to, you know, to continue my life here.
Now, that's quite a journey, isn't it? So I gather it was quite difficult for you to get into the system at all. I mean, it's amazing to me that you came here with no English whatsoever. And not only do you speak so fluently and elegantly now, but you also is a board certified family practitioner. To me, that's quite an achievement. But do you think that it was more difficult for you to apply for residencies as compared to an American graduate?
For sure, there is a big difference between somebody who knows the language, who mm-hmm. knows the system, mm-hmm. who looks, you know, standard to the system, rather than mm-hmm. somebody comes from outside, you know, mm-hmm. with dark hair, dark eyes, and a different accent, not knowing the whole language, you know, and mm-hmm. it's not easy to compete with them.
Mm. But there are other, you know, dark eyes, dark hair graduates from American schools too. I'm talking about Asians and, you know, Iranian in this country. Do you think that there's a difference just because you come from overseas? That's what I'm trying to say. What's your experience?
I think that it's much more difficult, but I'm looking at it from the point of view that most of the medical schools in this country you have to pay for. Mm-hmm. And if I am program director and I see someone who came from overseas mm-hmm. and I don't know how much money did he put in his country yeah. for the schooling, and I see the graduate from this country mm-hmm. who owns for the medical school $200,000.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So my first choice probably would be for the
so
USA
you think
graduate
that the
person.
The competition is fair.
I think the competition is fair. All my life I work in hard. I believed in hard work, mm-hmm. and I get the way I work. Mm-hmm.
I often wonder, you know, how an American born person would fare, you know, if he goes the other way around. You go to study medicine in Iran, in Vietnam, or Poland.
One thing that we should not forget that the foreign medical graduates. That's right. They don't pay for medical school as such that the American student is paying for, but they are giving up 4 years, 5 years of
yes.
their lives.
What yeah. we end up with, we are repeating medical school again mm-hmm. by hard work, very hard start here. I saw many broken hearts, broken physicians working on the street in San Francisco, mm-hmm. cleaning our.
Let's talk about the training in America a little bit. What is your general overview of your training in this country in anesthesia is compared to what you went through in Poland?
My Polish training was being a skin doctor, which I've got excellent training and I'm very proud of it, and mm-hmm. I have great knowledge and respect. Here I finished anesthesiology. It's quite different direction. I've been also lucky being accepted to one of the best UMass Medical Center anesthesia mm-hmm. residency. Mm-hmm. Where technically I've been wonderful trained mm-hmm. and they have a wonderful residency in this country. Mm-hmm. I can't compare this to family practice or medicine per se. In anesthesia you need a great training mm-hmm. and I think it was the best yeah. what could happen to me.
Let me ask you one question which may be difficult, but you know, what do you see is the one thing that stands out is wrong with the system in America that can be improved?
Compared
the medical care delivery in this country.
When I was studying in Kaplan for taking the board, always I was looking for something to teach me or ask me about medical ethics, you know, the patient as a patient, not mm-hmm. patient as a thing that you gotta be scared of it and this patient is gonna catch you sometimes. And I never find anything, but that was the thing that they were teaching me every day in my country, that patient, is a human being, and you have to mm-hmm. deal with him as a human. It's not a machine, it's not an object. Uh-huh. And that's the thing that I never seen, even during my residency, they never talked about that the patient is suffering or something like that. They were saying that if you don't do this, if you don't do that, if you don't document in the chart, they're going to come after you and you have to cover yourself. That was the whole thing, not the helping.
That's very interesting what you say, because medical ethics has become very recently a topic of discussion in certain circles, in certain hospitals.
I can compare many European physicians with USA graduate, mm-hmm. and there's a drastic difference between the applying of warmth, love, care for the patient mm-hmm. as Europeans or Asian or African doctors do.
Yeah.
And I see this missed in USA graduate physicians who just haven't been taught to freely give it and care
to
and
to the
love and warmth
level.
And really mm-hmm. touch the patient and send the yeah. kindness.
Yeah. Yeah, I agree. It seems to me that typical American graduate is very well trained technically. He knows what procedures to go to do, and he's very well trained technically. But in terms of relating to the patients, in general, they're pretty aloof. They keep the distance and they do the job. You know, they don't have the basic element of human warmth. I have to agree with that. Yeah.
Yes, they don't know how to. They are afraid. They think maybe it's overboard doing that, but mm-hmm. they many of them, I actually don't recall yeah. in my practice mm-hmm. many physicians who have that.
Mm-hmm. Well, why do you think that is the case?
I think that the way that the American medicine teaches in relation to the society and the laws and the regulations, they are always kind of protective medicine just to protect the physician or protect the person of being, you know, being abused or being harmed. Mm-hmm. And if the system teaches them that to manage the patient in a way that they are healing somebody and giving love and giving happiness, mm-hmm. and the system appreciate this kind of approach to the patient, mm-hmm. then the patient-doctor relationship is going to be much better and much
yeah.
helpful.
Well, I think one of the observations I have had is that in this country, in universities anyway, we are taught to diagnose diseases and find cure for them. But when you go out in practice, most people don't have a disease, and most diseases don't have a cure. It seems to me, you know, we concentrate so much on pathology, whereas my view of the of medicine is a very global issue. It has a lot to do with socioeconomics, a lot of ethics, philosophy, even the fine arts, whatever, and that's the part that is definitely lacking. And I agree with you because you see, I think we have very good training in America in certain aspects, and. I think the American graduates are very proud of that, you know. But even when I think about the training I had in Vietnam, there are certain things, very precious things that I learned that I would not learn here. So I'm just trying to say that each educational system has its own merits.
First year when I was doing internship in this country, when I tried to spend more time with patient mm-hmm. and give them security and warmth mm-hmm. and kind of protection and feeling me, I've been taken as a naive person doing that. Mm-hmm. And I had hard time with few attendings. Mm-hmm. Then over time, when they found out where I'm coming from, just to give more support, moral support for the patient, I accepted. Mm-hmm. But it was very difficult taken
yeah.
by them to accept this approach. Mm-hmm. It's something unreal. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, how do the patients accept you in your practice right now, the average patient that take care of?
Actually, they because from Poland, I learned of this givenness and warmth and caring. They love it. Mm-hmm. This is, you can't even explain, doing anesthesia and for a few seconds, you'd see this patient a few minutes before you put them to mm-hmm. sleep. And we're talking about almost death and life situation. Mm-hmm. And I have to make my patient trust me mm-hmm. that in this small hand, mm-hmm. he's going mm-hmm. to be awakened after
yeah.
2 hours, 3 hours, 5 hours.
Mm-hmm.
And at that time, I was giving the security.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the most of my experience comes from Polish schooling.
Yeah, yeah.
Of this trust that I can mm-hmm. give to the patient over mm-hmm. 5 minutes before putting him to sleep.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, one thing that I have noticed that most of the time when 80%, 90%, I have no problem with the patient and, you know, they accept you as a physician. They know that when you have that white thing on and you have your stethoscope hanging, probably mm-hmm. you know something, and then they trust you. Only less than 10 or 5% of the patients, when they see you as a foreigner, as a foreign medical graduate or somebody which is not speaking the same accent, first they don't trust you. But when you, when I deal with them, ask them the questions, and then give them the management, and try to help them, then they see, wow, this is totally different than the thing that they were thinking. And 90%, 95% of those patients, they came back to me and they appreciated the thing that I did. And that's the thing that gives
me. They are shocked. Sometimes they are shocked that they see someone nice and caring.
Yeah.
Because medicine is something that it doesn't relate to the objects. It's something. It's a kind of art, and art doesn't know the language, doesn't know the barriers.
Yeah. Yeah.
Music goes everywhere. You know?
Yeah. Actually, one of the speakers on my shows talk about exactly that. He qualifies medicine as a combination of a science, an art, and a business. But it seems to me like oftentimes in the business is spelled with a big B, and then the sign is a small S, and art is almost inexistent. It's a big business in this country. There's no question about it. And I don't know if it's necessarily good. You know, because you know, what do you think?
I work in the county hospital, and I enjoy this because I don't have to worry about the business part of my life. Mm-hmm. I can apply my directness to the patient without worry how much I'm going to build patient for that. And I think that this is the big difference between private and county hospital.
Mm-hmm. What do you think?
You cannot be a good physician if you think about business only.
Just can't.
Medicine is art, it's not business.
Yeah.
And you have to have a kind of a human sense to treat your patient. If you think, if you don't think this way, for sure you're going to find the wrong diagnosis, and your management is going to be.
Yes, you can't inject medication and put patient to sleep and think how much you can get out of it. You just can't, because you can make wrong injection.
Yeah.
You just can't.
So how are you being accepted by your American colleagues?
I never had any problems, so it's difficult for me to answer this. I am different. They learn from me something. I bet they do, and especially men. I am not many women becoming anesthesiologist, and I am lucky being a woman because before I put patient to sleep, I can touch patient, I can talk to him, I can relate more probably than men doctor can have because of harassment story and all the things. So as a woman, I think I have more field. Wider field to make my patient comfortable.
No, that's the patient, but I'm talking about your colleagues, your
my colleagues,
other physicians. Being a foreign medical graduate. You haven't had any problem, I got
I haven't had any problem. I am very straightforward and determined, and I stand for myself as a woman. And I probably ignore people who are not right, who don't show right attitude as a physician. I just ignore them. I don't talk to them. I don't say to them, but their ethics is wrong. And sooner or later, it will come out different ways.
How about you?
Yeah, that's the same thing that I example for the patients. The American physician, when they face foreign medical graduates, for the first time, they think that they are totally different people. But after having a little bit of close contact, then they feel that you know, they are same thing, and I've never had any problem, and always I've been happy with American colleagues.
Great. It's time just goes by so quickly. It's amazing. It's already toward the end of the show now. I really enjoy talking to you. I think that what you have demonstrated here is just so important. I never, one of the things that is amazing and very enjoyable about doing this show is that I never know what my guests are going to say. And obviously both of you are saying exactly the same thing, which is very valuable to me, and I'm hoping for our viewers. You're talking about the human quality of medical care, which is really lacking greatly in the landscape of business-like American practice in this country, and I think that's really so it's so refreshing to hear that, you know, because I think it's very important. I'd like to thank you for being here tonight, and Again, our show is America's Healthcare Crisis. Please write to us. Use the address and the correspond with us using the address on the screen. Tell us how we're doing. Give us suggestions as how we can improve our show. You just listened to two speakers, one from Poland and one from Iran, giving us the views from foreign medical graduates. I'm Dr. Hung Vu. Thank you for watching. Good night.
Thank you.
Thank you.
That's it.
You did very well.
So fast, I can't believe it.